Hi, and welcome to this new Smart Academy. I'm Francis Miles, the founder of Smart, and today I have not one guest, but two guests, Jordi and Jose. Hi, guys.
Hello.
Hello. Hello, everyone.
How are you today?
Fine, and you?
Fine, fine, very fine. So let me introduce them. So Jordi, you already know him because he was our guest a few weeks ago on Smart Academy to explain us his DOM and PBR workflow. And today he is with his friend and also boss, Jose, which is the founder of the creative studio called Iceberg. So Jose created Iceberg in 2013, and they both discovered Smart in 2016 and use it a lot on lots of different type of events since. So I think today we are going, so first of all, Jordi is going to finish everything he has to explain us about the DOM workflow. And then we will play a little game with Jordi and Jose. And by the way, we will do some experimentations of new workflows, cloud-based workflows for working with media servers. So it will both be an experiment, a technical experiment, and an artistic experiment.
Yeah.
that will be in the second part of today's session. So let's start immediately. And I think we can start with a video that Iceberg made on DOM.
Yeah.
And Jose and Jordi will comment us.
The audio is missing.
Empezamos poniendo un plástico en el suelo para poner encima el césped que estará dentro luego del domo y donde estará la gente estirada. Marcábamos el perímetro. Montamos puertas y a partir de ahí el lastre. 8 toneladas de arena en sacos de 25 kilos repartidas en todo el perímetro dentro de una lona que hace de base lastrada. Se pone la lona que luego se inflará y se convertirá en el domo, y también se ponen unos fuelles que van en las puertas para que todo esté perfectamente ensamblado. Ponemos la turbina en marcha y en cuestión de aproximadamente unos 20 minutos ya se infla.
En un entorno full DOM la ingeniería es muy exigente. Necesitamos unas máquinas que nos ofrezcan colores brillantes, negros profundos y tecnología fiable. Aquí lo encontramos.
Crear el contingut en Smoot ens permet fer-ho a temps real veient el resultat final sobre la superfície de treball. Llavors això a nivell creatiu ens ofereix tota una sèrie d'avantatges que fins ara no teníem. Podem crear un món digital que simula a la perfecció el món físic en el que anem a treballar. Dintre d'aquest món virtual creem tota una sèrie de càmeres que estan en la mateixa posició exacta que els nostres projectors, i això ens permet transformar qualsevol entorn tingui la forma que tingui.
Muy interesante porque nos permite transportar totalmente a los espectadores a otros mundos que no existen.
You can cut it through biology, you can cut it through chemistry, you can cut it through physics, and there's a facet of this story that's here to be able to like connect with people and try it.
És una experiència única, creus que formes part de la història i realment val molt la pena viure-ho.
Per a mi ha sido la hostia.
Experiencia brutal.
Jose and Jordi.
Yeah, Jose.
Well, yeah, this is a short video about how we assemble the DOM. And We use this structure for many kind of events, like corporate events, also cultural events, and we also make the content, which is where what we are going to show at the end of the streaming. And it's a full dome. It's like an IMAX. It's a spherical, spherical screen where we project with 5 projectors. We are getting a resolution about between 3K and 4K. And well, the people just lay down there and they enjoy the visuals that are totally immersive. We also put it every year in the Mira Festival, where we also are using Smoke for the mapping, and we invite our friends from Smoke every year to see it. And okay, I think it's a cool experience. It's a format that we really, really like, and that's it. I hope you will enjoy it.
Okay, thank you a lot, Jose. Let's continue with Jordi. So
yeah, so now that that we have showed what the dome, because this is the thing that I maybe missed the other day, just to show what a dome is. So now that we know, maybe we can go to the software and show how to set up a dome. So yeah, I'm on the server now. We just do this. Okay. So as you remember, for Dome Master, we used a square aspect ratio. So basically, I've drawn a content map, which now is about 4K resolution. Okay. Hello. You still there? I'm not listening to it, huh? Okay, so yeah. Good. Thank you, Basil. So yeah, we have our content map here, which is using a 4K by 4K resolution now. So then we can move to the stage. So we can create our surface, that which will be the dome. Here on the elements surface part, there is already one kind of preset full dome. You have both. One is exterior, which is intended to be projected from the exterior, and the other one is the full dome interior, which is the one that we are going to use now. So basically what this does is, we apply the content map here now, it creates an sphere with this content map applied to it. So now the next part will be to create a dome that makes sense with the real one. So the one in Iceberg is 16 meters diameter, so we are going to put here 8 meters radius. So now we have our real dome here on the stage. Then, as you can see here, if we move to the content map, let me just create a uniform layer so you could see that better. You can see here the geometry of the surface. So this is actually how the UV map it's done on the content map. But what happens now is that if I put here, we usually use this template. Let me check this one. This is a kind of template that we use. So this is really useful because we have the north, the south, west, nest points here. Also we have the degrees, and we have many, many lines that helps us then with the warping workflow. But now you can see that if we go here, this is not correctly applied. And this is because of how the UV maps are made by default here. So one trick that we found to solve this, in one way we can model this before and do the correct UV map on our preferred software. But now what we're going to do is just apply here a UV mapping. So we are going to change the UV map of this. So this is not necessary. UV mapping, set it in perspective mode. And just rotate this 90 degrees and move the camera a little bit until we find here. It's a bit messy when the server is okay, and it should go like this. So now what we have done with this kind of trick is we actually changed the UV map of our 3D surface. So now you can see that this is also a circle, which is what we are which is the format that the Dome Master gives us. So now if I apply back this pattern, also I'm going to rotate this 180 degrees. So the north is here. We usually work on this way. So this is the north, south, east, west. And now if we go back to the stage, what we can see is that this is now correctly displayed. So this is basically the first step we do. So what comes next is the video projector setup. So as Jose told you before, we project our dome using five 10K laser projectors. So we are going to create them right now. Let's create this. Yeah, this is the surface we want to see with that projector. And our dome doesn't start at the same level as the floor. So we have like about 2 meters height here. Correct me, Jose, if I'm wrong, but I think it's like 2 meters height here almost.
Yeah.
So we usually put the projectors as far from the middle as we can. So usually it's about 7 meters because we need to have some room for the projector. And right now we will leave it here, or maybe sometimes it's like about 20 centimeters under the where the projection starts, or maybe a bit less. And also what we are using lenses of 0.8 radio. So now if I go here to video projectors, we start seeing what the projector is actually seeing and also projecting. So usually then we put it like this and we play with the lens shift just to make to find the correct adjustment in relation to the real projector. So this will be projector number one. Then we can easily duplicate this, and this will go just in front of this one. but rotate it 100 degrees. And then we'll do the same for the third and fourth projector, but we will not be moving them on the z-axis, but on the x-axis. So 7 meters here, 90 degrees here, and now just duplicate that and put it on the other side. Again, this, and this is gonna be 270 degrees. So now we can go to our simulation and just check what's happening here. Let me put these projectors at 10,000 lumens and just decrease a little bit this max illumination here. So now we see this better. So this is basically the setup for the environment, but then we are missing the Zenith one, which is usually the most difficult to warp, because we usually put it next to one of these, but on the floor level. So let's say we are going to duplicate this one, for example, number 4. And what we do usually is this is on floor level, so this will go like -2 meters, no, a bit more, -2.4, so this makes more sense. This goes a little bit in front of the other one, and then we just rotate it until we cover the whole dome. As you can see here, it looks...
Jordi, for my own personal culture, but don't you use the vertical shift of the projectors also?
Yeah, and this one, we used to rotate it a little bit. We have like a custom base that we did, so we can move the legs and put it on different orientations. So basically we put it on, we rotate it a little bit, and then we finally play with the lens shift. Like if this is on 0, we must rotate this a lot. So usually we find an intermediate point between the rotation and the lens shift. And yeah, so what this is projecting is something like this. So yeah, this is the most difficult one, because as you will know, we start warping the projectors on the sides. So we start with number 1 and number 3, for example. On this part, they are... we need to do blending and warping. So the thing is that we start always doing the warping on the sides, and when we finish, we start we do the zenith one, which is the most difficult, because its position is more complicated than the other ones, since it's here on the floor and a little bit rotated. And also because you have to warp this with the other 4 video projectors. So this is where things get more difficult when warping the dome. But yeah, we must say that before using this mode, we were using Resolume, also some custom BBBB templates, and we tried different softwares, and since we start doing the warping in this mode, things are faster than before, just because of it's really the thing that we can have a real representation of what we have. It helps us a lot on the warping process. So lately there has been some days that we made the full warping in about 2 hours or something like this, which is kind of crazy because there are many projectors and the surface is quite complex. So yeah, Smote really helps us on this kind of workflow.
Yeah, and also once you have made the project one time, you have it forever.
Yeah.
Every time you reinstall the DOM somewhere else, you can start from the same.
Yeah, yeah, that's also the thing. So we usually make copies and copies of the same project, but we always have like a clean project, which is just a full DOM with the projectors on its place. So then it's more a thing about trying to assemble the DOM in the same way and just to have really clear where we put the projectors always. So then everything makes sense. And when you go back again, maybe 1 or 2 months later or whatever, it's kind of easy to do the warping because you almost have it from the other time. That's one of the keys.
I'm forwarding a question from Sebastian, by the way.
Yeah.
Two questions. One is, you don't want to project till the floor, so maybe just explain that your DOM is not at the floor level, but it starts above the floor, actually.
Yeah, what we have is, our DOM is 210 degrees. Right now, this one is at 180 degrees. But now ours really has some more projection surface here, and then the, like the basement, I don't know the name in English, but it's like a kind of belt that handles all the dome. It's full of sandbags, so this maintains the dome static when there is a lot of wind. But yeah, maybe you can
answer also.
Yeah, of course, Jose.
The thing here is in 210 degrees, we can project below the horizon. And this setup is used for when the people is stand up. The other thing is that we need that 8 projectors or 6 projectors to do it. And but when the people is laying down, start projecting from 2 meters and 180 degrees, it's much better for the experience because of the field of view of the people, and it's more immersive. If we just wrap this, also we need to make the content into 210 degrees, and it's another way to create the content. You need to really think about the point of view of the people. And for most festivals or events we are doing, all the people lays down, and it's easier to enjoy this experience than a stand up. That's it.
Yeah, so real floor goes like this almost. So let me do this a little. So yeah, as you can see, there are almost 2 meters from the floor to where we start the projection.
Okay, thank you, that's clear. And also, Sebastian was asking about the Viozo auto-calibration module. So maybe I can answer this one. We have an integration of Viozo inside Smote,
yeah,
which enables to directly recover the calibration files from a Viozo system. So it really depends on if you are equipped with this type of equipment or not. So
we will. We already know Viozo, but we never used it.
Okay.
But we know that it's correctly implemented in Smote, and yeah, will be cool to try it someday in the in the DOM. So yeah, basically this is the setup. So then I will not go so farther with this since we are not warping anything right now, but yeah, the thing is that then with this we can do the warping and also the blending. We do it from here, and yeah, that's it. Maybe I can create a quick scene right now, just to do a reminder on.
Maybe I could show you some tips and tricks quickly on the button.
Yeah, of course.
I have to go with DOMS. Let me take the server. So we were in VP5. Yeah, the first thing to know is that with the mapper, which is a relatively recent feature in SMUD, you can very easily, let's go in placing some points. You can very easily place 4 different points. So usually we'll take points which are easy to localize or which corresponds to the structure you are projecting on. And then you can immediately move those 4. So this will take care of a big part of the required deformation. And also, by the way, you can use keys, arrow keys, and combine with Control and Shift to make it very precise, like 10% of the pixel or even 1% of the pixel. So you can really move in details.
Yeah, this precision is crazy.
Yeah, and once you are done with this, you can switch to the Bezier mode. Or even important is to lock once you are done with your deformation, because as long as you deform, maybe Basil can show us the outputs if I connect it. So to VP5, can you show us the, yes. So what we see now is the output of VP5. And as you can see, the mouse position is projected with green lines, and this helps a lot to visualize what you are doing. And once you are done with the calibration, you can lock it and they will disappear. Usually the second step when projecting on curved surfaces is then to use the Bezier renderer or even the Bezier patch, but let's start with Bezier. So you need to switch your edit on, and then you can have a very good control over the precise deformation. So that's one trick. Also, in order to figure out the soft edges of the Zenith projector, one way to go is to put all the projectors in white. Let's switch to simulation. So now all my projectors are fully white. I'm going to put the top in black. And then inside this projector, I'm going to look at how the stage preview looks like. So for this, I need to create, I don't have it here, maybe. Oh, I'm not in the right menu. Pipeline. So stage simulation is what I want in this case. And by looking at this stage simulation, I immediately can see how the other video projectors will overlap with my projector. And starting from this image, we have a very good starting point in order to create the appropriate soft edges.
Yeah, that's a very good trick.
Yeah, did you know it?
No.
That's why I wanted to show.
I'm still learning also, today.
We have all to learn things.
Yeah.
And also maybe to show another trick, so we need to go back to the mapper, is for the side projectors. So if we look at one of those. Contents, let's see. This one, which is better to understand. So the thing here is the overlap of those projectors implies curves which are not trivial. So if you go for 2D soft edges, you will have to deform them in order to follow the curve, and it might be a bit complex. So what we can do instead is to play at the level of the content map. So how can we do this? with so the trick will be to use a layer mask. In this layer mask, we are going to set it as a compo. In this compo, there is a uniform which will be like a band, like this. And we will use the polar coordinates modifier. So let's go back to the compo. On the compo. And now my uniform is like selecting slices inside the dome master shape, and if I want, I can use a mask in order to get my soft edges. So let's go back to the compo and put some feeder so on the left and right side. Yes, and that's about the type of soft edges we need for our projector. So now if we go back to see the video projector, we can see that by moving this layer, I'm directly taking the right slice of the content. So
3D blending.
Yeah, and then we have exactly soft edges in the UV space, actually. I can make it larger with the scale, and that's the type of things we usually need for soft edges. So I really like this technique because it's much smarter. So here, since we are working in Dome Master, we need to use this polar coordinate modifier. But if we work with equirectangular content, then it's even more simple because it's simply a rectangular slice. And you can do it directly with a placement mask. So you don't need all the layer mask compo and so on stuff. So yeah, that was it. And did you know that second one, Jordi?
Yeah, I know that because you showed us at Mira Festival 2 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. You did the mask on the door, showing us this trick.
Yeah,
so I think we are done with this, and maybe we can move to the second part to play a little bit with Jose.
To conclude this one, we could do create a little processor that shows all the video projectors.
I was thinking to do it later when we finish with Jose, but yeah, already we'll got it already. So yeah, you can create it.
Okay, let's create one quickly. So what I want is to have my projectors. How many we have? Five. This requires some calculation. Times 3 and times 2. So I'm just creating a big processor that contains all the images. So 6 images. And then we will be able to see them all together. We need this one and this one, and we still have one left for a preview, maybe. These are all our signals. Compact it into one, and now I'm just going to select the final output of Swell to be that one, and then you will be able, Basil will be able to show all the signals to you. And I will let you continue.
It's good. Okay. Okay. So yeah, we can start with the second part, Francis.
Yeah, sure. So you wanted to show us some content inside of this?
Yeah, but since we are running a little bit out of time, I think we can start working with Jose, and we will see it there anyway.
Okay, sure.
So Now one thing I'm going to do is just switch to better resolution just to work now, which is going to be 1K square. So then we can push the things with the software.
New placement shortcut, Control Alt F. Yeah.
So yeah, the idea now is that Jose and me will work together on the same composition at the same time. I will be working on the background and he will be working on the foreground. And the way we have this set up is that I'm working on a server, Jose is working on another server. They both are connected via SmoothNet, and we are using a shared folder just to have access to the same files on both computers. So if you are ready, Jose, we can start.
Maybe before starting, you can simply show what happens on both computers when you do something on both sides, because to explain to everybody, so the SmoothNet is pretty similar to Google Documents, for example. So any collaborator can do something in its own SMOD, and it will be reflected in the other SMODs that are on the network. So you can show us maybe the network menu to show the different machines which are connected together. Yeah, so now we have these two machines which are together, and a master and another server. And on both sides, the two collaborators can do a change, like activate a layer, for example, and it will be immediately reflected on the other side. So that's a way to work together. Usually we
do this on a
local network. And now we investigated this through the use of a VPN, which enables us to deploy this on multiple sites simultaneously. So we can work together, like today, for example, Jose is in his home place, Jordi is in his home place, they are not together, but they are going to work together on SmoothNet.
Good. So yeah, just to see, for example, now I can create a compo here, which is going to be called background. And right now, I'm not touching the mouse, so Jose, you can create another compo so everyone can see that you are already creating these components on your server, but it will be, yeah, that Perlan noise, for example. So yeah, this is basically the idea. So in that way, we can work on the same project and on the same scene, but of course, we must make sure which part of the scene will do each other, but yeah, the idea is to be able to work on the same project at the same time.
I think we can start, guys, now.
Yeah, I think so. Okay, so yeah, I'm going for the background and Jose for the foreground.
A countdown: 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Let's go, guys.
Go, okay, go, go. Come on. Vamos. Vamos, Jose. So yeah, always the first step is to create the DOM master camera.
Oh, really?
You know the software, Jose?
More or less.
You heard about it?
Yes.
Somewhere.
It's After Effects, right?
Yeah, something like this. So you brought some stuff with you, Jordi, I see. Can you explain your data files?
Sorry?
You brought some stuff with you.
Yeah, today. This is it's the same 3D mesh that I was trying to use the other day, but today we are going to use it correctly. So yeah, basically it is a 3D file that I modeled in ZBrush, then import it to Substance Painter to do the texturing, and yeah, then I get many textures for all of the channels. So it's just a thing of importing right now. So it looks like this right now. I'm going to add some HDR light. I don't want to see the render.
You can just unfold Jose's compo so we can see.
Ah, yeah, sorry.
Okay. So, Jose, you can explain what's happening. Jose, you are doing the particles, right? Can you explain us?
Sorry?
You were doing particles, right, Jose?
Yes, what I'm doing here is a share compo, which uh-huh. is very simple particles in a equirectangular map. And I will use this compo to displace my FBX file and to create some shapes with this Thailand Buddha. Also, I have here a PBR texture, which I just downloaded from the Algorithmic webpage.
Uh-huh.
And yes, that's it. I will now drop my media here.
Benefit from this little time to answer the question from Roma, so which is asking if we plan to do a session about how to set up .NET from start. So we did not do it, so we didn't miss it. We were thinking about doing it, but to be totally honest, we have planned a big refactoring on the .NET to make it easier to set up, because for the moment .NET is something really, really powerful. That's a bit difficult to set up and to avoid all the traps it contains. So we have a big refactoring in plan, and we were thinking not to explain it in detail now, and just keep it like if you need it, you call us and we can do it together on case by case. But we will first do our refactoring, simplify everything, and then explain it more in depth.
Jordi, maybe we should share the camera.
Yeah. Let me. So I think that to be able to have different lightnings, I'm gonna put this here, and I'm going to share. Expose 3D position, expose the orientation also,
connect to
expose. Ah, yeah, and then now I'm gonna connect Jose's camera to mine, so
yeah, so indeed camera sharing is not supported yet, so that's I think the best way to proceed. Or maybe you could have put the camera above in a common group, but that's, I think, is okay.
Yeah, because to be able to do different compositing, we need to have it on different compos, so they need to have the camera inside, I think. Okay. But yeah, now we are...
Okay, great.
Two different cameras, but...
Yeah.
We are all on the same. We are all in the same place. So this is the kind of a sky. These are the mountains. Okay.
Maybe we could see a bit more quickly preview. Jordan? Yeah. How does it look? So that's the 3D scene, and maybe you can show what the state preview.
Yeah.
So you need to remove the green arrow. On the stage preview.
Yeah, so this is how it's looking right now, and here on the processor side we can see each part on each projector.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Very hard to follow everything which is happening.
Yeah, well, right now what I'm trying to do is to emit particles from my imported 3D object, but I want to mask them so they only project from these more orangey parts. So this, which I don't see now.
What's happening on your side, Jose?
Well, I'm using this shared compo as a displacement of the geometry, then I repeat it to make this mandala.
Uh-huh.
And now what? Basically, I had to put a UV mapping tag, a UV mapping to make these UVs spherical, as my shared compo is an equirectangular. And now I'm gonna play with the 3D transform, but I had to put the 3D transform before the repeater in order to make this mandala more interesting. Otherwise, if the 3D transform, if the 3D transform is below the repeat, I just repeat the whole object, and this is not what I want to do.
Yes. Makes sense.
It's a bit tricky to play with the server, with the values on the server. But...
Yeah, better to write it than to do a slide.
Yeah.
Today, the main issue we have with cloud servers is that the drag and drop is not as fine as we are used to in product. Hmm. And it's a bit difficult for us to find a solution to do. Because drag and drop is something very, very important when doing this model. We have a question in the same time, which is how many users can use this in the same time. So, in principle, there is no limit. In practice, I think the main bottleneck for the moment is that we have no clear feedback from who is doing what. It quickly becomes a bit messy because you don't know if you are fighting each other or not. So in general, you need
to... No, the idea it wasn't a fight, but was more than like a collaborative...
But when you are five people collaborating, sometimes you work in the same places and not always doing the same thing. And I think it will become better when we have once we have the feedback from every user who is where doing what. And also for bigger productions, we need like an authorization system, because we don't want people doing video projectors calibration to be able to modify the content or stuff like that. So these are really the like the next steps. For the moment on the SmartNet, what we do first is get something that works on real scale, on big productions. So it's still a bit custom and on purpose, but it's really reliable. We used it at the Millen Farmer tour preparation, and it was up to 4 people working simultaneously on the show on a network of 14 servers plus the operator laptops. So it can really scale up, and it's clearly revolutionary way of working.
This feedback is really weird. It's not working as... do you know, Francis, why it's keeping this color here?
So I have a very low resolution of your own feedback, Jose, and it's very hard for me to see.
The thing is, even if I change the feedback level, it's still giving me a gray feedback.
I think you should put the quality and go to HDR. Yeah, put the quality of the comp in HDR and maybe the gamma value to 1. And
here?
You will have a quality feedback.
Here, you mean?
Okay,
perfect. Okay, thank you.
So we have another question from Sebastian, which is, does SMUD network for all features? And the answer is yes, mostly everything works with SmartNet. So you can work on both the project, the pipeline and the content. And mostly everything is supported with the SmartNet. So creating effects, modifying parameters, modifying timelines, importing new scenes, etc. Yeah, so the main limit is that it has to be everything inside one project, because it is the project that is shared in the SmartNet. So if you want to work on compost, they need to be inside the show of the project. We should put some Goa music, no?
Yeah!
And take some acid.
I'm going to use Francis' trick for colorizing particles with an HDRI. So I'm using the colorized texture layer. So then let me find what HDRI map, this one works.
Yeah, let me use this too. I will take your HDR map also. Are you sharing it? No.
No. But it's a standard one, Cape Hill.
You could share it, I think, huh?
Yeah. Sorry?
You can share it, I think, the map.
Yeah, we are actually using the same, Cape Hill.
Yeah, okay. Just to show as a proof of concept, because if you share it, then you can change the environment map, and it will change in both the compose from.
Yeah, that's true. So yeah, that. Now okay. I did one reference. I'm gonna put it on your light, Jose.
I did it already.
Ah, okay.
Magic.
Boom. So we have same camera.
I think you made a dirty reference, Jordi.
Sorry?
You created a dirty reference just before the sky.
A reference for what?
This one? Oh, sorry.
Ah, this one, yeah. I have this one.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I create this one, which is the inside here. This is the diffuse channel, and also layer mask for particle emitter. So right now I'm emitting particles from just the orange parts of the 3D mesh. So what I'm doing is here I have a particle system which is emitting from the FBX, but there I have here I have this referenced map, which basically I desaturate it and I just push a bit the brightness and contrast to have a clear white, black and white mask. So now, yeah, Basil, tell me. Sorry? Oh, fuck. I don't know here. This all here, and this is not useful. Okay, I'm done. So these particles, I'm going to change this to screen. Maybe we can increase this a little bit.
Well, we are running 20 FPS.
And less now that I'm pushing the particles, but just let me just go back.
You are in the same boat.
Yeah.
I think that what I learned during the SMOD Academy is that we need to create a shortcut in order to create the exposure effect.
A shortcut for?
To create the exposure modifier.
Ah, yeah.
It's like the most universal effect on SMOD. Everybody uses.
Everybody use the exposure. I'm not really achieving what I was looking for.
Yeah, we also maybe need to share the lights. You don't have any more light, right?
No, just that big one.
Maybe we can put some. If we put it outside the compo, it will work, I guess, right?
Yeah, I think so.
No, it must be inside.
It's a bit frustrating for me not to be on the planet station.
So this is
Nobody
gave me.
I cannot create lights inside the whole compo. So. Just. Boom. It won't affect yours. Sorry, this is me.
It's you? Okay. safe.
It's not gonna work. Well, yes, it's working.
Wow. So maybe we could show what happens if we play with the camera parameters?
Yes. Yeah, I was thinking that. Do you want to do it, Jose? Or
these ones, these parameters?
They are exposed up on the compo.
Okay. Oops. I think it's my particles are killing the GPU.
I think both of us are killing the GPU.
So maybe it's time to use the profile button and see who has the most.
What's happening?
Whoa!
Whoa, so close!
Yeah, close. Jose is a bit above.
Let me just add some particles here and we'll see.
Okay. You still can make it slow. So probably at some point we need to allocate milliseconds to surface, allowed milliseconds, because the GPU remains shared. Because you are creating a new combination of effects which generates a new shader, and the shader is being built, so that's when spot credit. And once the shader is built, it goes into the shader cache. And you don't have the freeze anymore.
Well, this is looking good, I think.
Can we see it on the 3D preview?
Yeah, wait a moment. I want to put this back. No. Let me show again.
So just we have a remark from Toph that said that he crashed SMUD using the project Dancing with SMUD that we provided a few days ago. So this project is particularly expensive because it created a lot of lights and volumetric lights and so on. So it requires a good computer. But in case you have questions, you are always welcome to send them to us at support@smod.fr, and we will have a look at them, see if they can learn us something. In general, on the good machine, SMUD crashes really hard.
Well, I think we have a nice camera now. One of the most important things when you are making full DOM content is to go inside things, to go to really move the camera inside your scene. It's what it's where it really gets immersive. Yeah, Jordi, maybe you can colorize these particles.
Oh, yeah, no. This is what I'm after.
It's right on the now. Plan. Okay. Okay, we are 13 FPS, man.
Always on the limit. I think, Jose, I will make the camera not go that low, so we don't go below the
okay.
The surface. Is this? Yeah. So this can go from 0.1. Wow.
Nice.
What time is it? Wow.
Yeah, it's 6:30. It was pretty impressive to see this collaborative working. So we have another question from Sebastian, which asked if the performance drop was related to the mix of DOM and equilateral camera. But I think it's related to the addition of everything, the performance drop, because when we look at the profile button, we can see it's really dispatched between all the different layers. So in general, of course, DOM is expensive because you do 6 renderings for each point of view, and then you still have some processing to put it in the DOM master or equilateral rectangular format. So now we are not on the best possible server, it's a Smod Academy server, but not the most powerful that exists. And it would be good to retest it from some release on this machine to go farther in the limits. But in general, the idea is to have interactive speed for creating the content, and then you can render this out and play it back as a movie.
What's happening here? I don't know what's happening right now with my particles here on the back, but
it's the knot. The knot is
yeah, but looks like there's no particles. It looks like just a single point, but there should be many particles there, and maybe because of the speed. Yeah, that's the thing.
Jordi, you are burning the GPU, take care.
Yeah, I'm always burning the GPU. That's what I like to do. GPU burn.
The server is now actually doing the whole stream, connecting all of us together and doing this at the same time. So a lot for one single machine. So I see you are creating a lot of fields in your content, and I wanted to say that that's exactly what's coming next in the Squad Academy. So we will have a session next Monday after the weekend dedicated to advanced particles, so fields, physics, rules, conditions and actions. And I will present this with my colleague Erwan. So that will be the topic of next Monday's Squad Academy session. And also, by the way, so next week we will continue doing three sessions during the week. One will be Monday on advanced particles, and the two others will be on Wednesday and on Friday. So I don't exactly know how long you want to continue. Guys, it's really interesting to look at you.
We could spend the whole evening if necessary.
Maybe we can do a vote on the live chat. Do you people want us to continue?
Yeah, but it's looking nice now.
Yeah, crazy. Craziness.
Yeah.
Now the near clipping, we need to change of both cameras.
Yeah, it's looking nice now.
Whoa. What else we can do here?
That's crazy, huh?
More particles.
Yeah, I was trying this knot thing, but I'm not really getting what I want now. This place.
I think it's pretty much there. I don't know how can I improve it. So let's just finish these background particles. For me, it's cool. It's okay.
Okay. So.
Wow.
Control. Okay, I don't need this.
I want to see this in the dome.
Yeah, it will be good.
Remember? So hopefully after quarantine we can do the same in the actual dome. A big one-night session with dozens of users. I'm happy you use my trick, Jordi.
Yeah, that's yours. I'm not really getting what I want, but let me just make a solo here. Ah, because I don't want to use this, I prefer Hansa Plus works better for this HDRI trick. So let me check this just again. Okay, files.
Maybe you need to disable the dev test?
Ah, maybe. Let me check.
Yeah,
you're here.
And reduce a bit the alpha.
Yeah, for the threshold.
Oh, no, no, not the threshold, you can leave it.
Yeah, no, but I tried before and I prefer it with a bit of threshold, so I don't see the black light outline.
There is another solo left on the group.
Okay. Yeah, this HDRI trick is really nice for particles.
Yeah, there is also, I think, a good remark from Sami Rotaneva, which says that ISF like tapestry fractal also look cool as colorized texture layer with particles. So I can believe him. And I think, by the way, that the type of shaders that we saw, HDR shaders, like we saw Martin, could be very good candidates also for maps inside the polarized texture layer.
Yeah. Sorry? My hand in front of my camera? Ah. Optical flow. How do you think? Yeah, I think it's looking really nice now.
Crazy.
I still did not get what I was looking for on this not particle thing, but anyway, it's working. Good, so what do you think, Jose?
Well, yeah, are we done? It would be a nice challenge. You did it.
Yeah.
That's really cool. I propose you save this compo and then we can share it as usual on our
Academy. It's saved.
Super.
Yeah, nice. And so we let you play and maybe finish this live and show you the final result. I think maybe also what we can do is a little video export, like in 4K, for example. We will do this after the live.
Okay.
And provide the export file just as an example of what you can create in half an hour with mod and two people using Spandex. So thanks a lot, Jordi and Jose.
Thank you for inviting us.
Thank you.
Thanks everybody for watching us since several weeks already on Squad Academy. And thank you for your enthusiasm in this academy. And I wish you the best possible weekend. Stay safe, stay at home, and see you next week for the following of Squad Academy. And thank you again, Jose and Jordi. I was really happy to have both of you.
Good.
Interactive net online experiments. So that was nice.
We are happy also.
Thank you. Thank you.
So thank you, everybody.
Enjoy your weekend.
Hope to see you soon again.
Okay. Bye bye.
Always welcome. Bye bye.
Okay. Bye. Goodbye.